Now the tally is complete for this session. Let's begin with the question and answer, please. You're from Ghana. Would you kindly, before asking the question, introduce yourself?
Yes, sir.
Hmm?
Yes, sir.
Please.
I'm Malik Al Hassan Yakubu. I'm MP from Ghana. I'm the chairman of the Jalsa committee in Ghana. I'm a member of the Majlis Amla.
And also, you are the leader of opposition or what?
I am.
You play some role in the opposition.
Yes, I am the chairman of the youth wing of the main opposition party, and also the shadow minister for interior.
Right.
And my party is called New Patriotic Party, NPP.
That's very good. Excellent. Okay. This time, both the members of Ghana, I mean, not there were so many, but two members of Ghana. One represented the government, the other opposition.
That is so, Your Holiness.
And while in Jalsa, they were like brothers.
That is so.
Right?
And even back at home, we maintain it.
Yes. So, please, you want to ask a question or what?
Yes, Your Holiness. Assalamu alaikum,
Huzur. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
I, being in politics and also being Ahmadi, wanting to be a good Ahmadi.
Yes.
The Quran requires that you should give respect, you should obey lawful authority. But when you have a bad government and you are Muslim, what conduct should you put up?
You see, you must obey the government. Bad or good is not your responsibility. But if you give the right to individuals to choose between the bad and good with regard to governments, then any Tom, Dick and Harry can decide that because I think this is bad, so Islam absolves me of my obedience to this. This is not true. This will create chaos. That is why Ahmadiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, naturally guided by the Quran, said that even if you have an authority, I mean anyone representing authority, he holds political authority over you, even if his head is as small as a resin, even if he belongs to anywhere, even if he cannot clearly think, as long as he remains in authority, you must obey him. It's a fantastic thing.
It is.
To obey the authority is one principle which is admonished by the Holy Quran, but at the same time, the Holy Quran leaves room for not disobedience, but obedience to a higher authority. When the two clash, obedience to a lower authority and the obedience to the higher authority, when they do come into clash, then the Islamic principle, clear-cut, without ambiguity, is you must follow the higher authority. This is why the Holy Quran says, "Atiyu Allaha wa atiyu Rasula wa ulil amri minkum." This exactly is the question you have raised. The Holy Quran says, "Believe and obey God and obey His Prophet, and also obey those who hold political authority among you." فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي الشَّيْنِ. If you disagree on certain points with relation to your religion, for instance, then the Holy Quran says, do not present them to all these three authorities. Present them to the authority of the Prophet and the authority of God, and follow them. This verse of the Quran has given me the guideline to deal with the situation in Pakistan. I have told them to obey the government in everything, even if it is injurious to you, even if it is harmful to you, you have to obey. Because in Mecca, while the Meccans treated the Muslims surrounded in Mecca most beastly and horrendously, they treated them as if they did not exist, if they had no life. I don't want to repeat the history, but still Hazrat Muhammad told them, you have no right to rebel while remain within their territory. So physical harm the authority may do, but that authority should also be obeyed in the civic laws and political legislation, etc. But when they break the law of God, when they compel you to disobey God, then offer every sacrifice, but do not disobey God. Here again, a rebellion is not permitted. We see such instances in the lifetime of the Holy Prophet ﷺ that in Mecca, some people were tortured even to death. Still they were not permitted to rebel, but to accept that torture, but not obey the enemy. They were tortured because they said their prayers. They were tortured because they said, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. The Holy Prophet told them, you continue to say La ilaha illallah, this is the defiance of law. The only area of defiance which is mentioned here. Continue to say your prayers. Yet you do not rebel and offer yourself for every sacrifice. But if you cannot take it anymore, you leave the country. Then you have the right to attack the country from outside the territory. You have the right to pay them in the same coins, but first you leave the territory, then come back, and they should know here is our enemy, you know.
Yeah.
This is the Quranic teaching. In the light of what I have said, you don't face any problem at all.
Not just so.
Do you?
No.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
In the Holy Quran, there is numerous verses which indicate.
Now you are from South Africa. Why don't you introduce yourself, please?
I'm a South Africa Secretary of Tarbiyat and Finance
in Jamaat.
Yeah,
that's right. Please.
Okay. In the Quran, there are numerous verses which indicate that most people will not believe. When Allah refers to certain subjects in the ends of the verse that most people will not believe or they fail to see. And as the Quran is eternal or till the end of time, will it be always so that most people will not believe?
You see, when the Holy Quran repeats this phrase, most people do not believe, it repeats it in a given situation. When the Quran says, this is what God is, this is what the Prophet is, mm-hmm. yet most people do not believe. This is always true.
Till the end of time?
Till the end of the time. Most of the believers even don't believe in what the Quran says. So it's a reflection on the obliviousness of mankind. Mankind lives in a state of stupor and oblivion. They think they believe, but when you probe deeper, you realize they do not believe in anything. So the Quranic statement is universal.
Like Allah.
Yes, from America this time, huh?
Mohammed Sabah from America, presently holding.
Introduce yourself.
Introduce myself.
Yes.
I'm Mohammed Sabah from America, and I am public relations officer for Milwaukee's Jamaat, and
But before that, what you were and what you are. Tell us.
I'm the president of the International Martial Arts Association in the Ahmadiyya movement, 6-degree black belt, and I have a question.
Before that, how many laurels you won from the American state?
I've been national champion in karate twice.
This is what he is not telling us. Out of his modesty, I know him. You were wanting to refer to that.
Numerous regional championships, uh-huh. and a number of students have won national championships.
When he shakes hands, his hand is so soft and mild, nobody can realize what he is. But when he displays his art, he can break 3, 4, 5 layers of concrete, one shot. And no harm done to his hand. Now you put your question.
My question is, my question relates to my profession.
Yes.
And that is, in our Jamaat, in our location, there's a gentleman that does a TV program, and he talks harshly against the promised Messiah.
Right.
I don't like it.
You don't use your profession against him, please. That is the question, this is the answer.
I don't like it.
I don't like it either. But the question is, anyway, any man who impales you with words and not spares, he must be answered in the same terms.
Yes.
The concept of holy war is in fact misunderstood by the people in the world generally. The holy war does not make the choice of weapons. According to the Holy Quran, the choice of weapons is always made by the enemy. If you are attacked with material weapons, the Holy Quran entitles you to defend yourself with the same material weapons. If you are attacked by, for instance, invectives and false allegations, etc., etc., there are two things which the Holy Quran tells you. You can revenge yourself, but remember that by taking the same revenge, you will become yourself, you will debase yourself as well. So there the same weapons are not permitted. When you use the same language against such people, you will debase yourself. So take care of yourself. You can defend yourself in argument, with logic, with references to the scriptures, etc., etc. But in your polemics with an enemy, you must take care of your own dignity. This is the answer to your question. That man attacks you with words. You can revenge against him with dignity. With defense of what he says, of course, it's solid defense of that. But your words should be dignified and honorable. In the long run, you will win the battle. Because the purpose of jihad is to win the battles. Every listener who would listen to his, what we call Unurdu Bakwas, you know, rubbish. And when he listens to your response, he would most certainly be impressed by your response to that filthy man. And that is your victory over him. Understand?
Yes.
But don't use your martial arts against him, please. Because your one stroke will destroy him and put you to jail and destroy you in the sense that you will be lost to us as well.
Yes.
Okay.
Jazakallah.
Assalamu alaikum, sir. My name is Abdul Hamid from Holland.
Yes.
I am editor of the Muslim Dutch language magazine Al Islam. I'm also translating some literature. I have a question. Yes. In paradise or hell, are there only the souls of the human beings of this earth, or also the souls of beings from elsewhere in the universe?
Yes. Other than humans?
Other than humans, yeah. Elsewhere in the universe.
Do they have souls?
I don't know, Hazrat.
No, you read the Quran, you have translated it.
We have souls.
We have souls?
Yes.
But other animals, do they have souls?
I think so.
Do you ever find any reference in the Quran or Hadith where God breathes life into the animals?
Yes.
No. Or it is always specific to humans.
Yes.
And confined to humans. Whenever Allah speaks of soul, ruh,
yeah,
ruh is never mentioned with relation to animals. Yasalunaka anil ruh. Qul ar-ruhu min amri rabbi. They ask, according to the Quran, about the soul. Tell them the soul is another name for the order of God. Amr. Now this Amr is breathed into Adam, this Amr is breathed into every prophet of God, and every human is related to this Amr for having a soul. But nowhere in the Quran you will read that God breathed into animals
Yes.
and gave them a soul. Nafs, of course, is common. Nafs is the name of life. So they share the life with us, but not that developed form of life, which when separated from human body, can live independently. That is soul.
Right.
It's once it comes into being, that even if it's totally broken away from the container, that is body, it has no contact left at all, still it would survive. The only question which arises is, how can a mere spirit or soul, which was given birth by the body and the body looked, took care of developing it, could leave the body and yet remain, yet survive? This question has been agitating the minds of many religious and also non-religious people, and they used to poo-poo the idea of soul, as religious people believe. But not very recent, but some few years ago, the physicists themselves discovered the existence of solitons. They are a package of forces, electric forces, wave force, whatever you call them, but they are a package of forces, bundle of forces, which survives independently itself without matter being its container. This was the most mind-boggling thing they discovered. And I read some articles on this issue. First of all, let me describe what soliton is. You know, when you see a boat being driven whether by motor or by mechanical means, like horses sometimes drag a boat behind. In America it often happens. You see a pattern of waves being left behind the boat. It spreads in all directions. When the moment the boat stops, that pattern does not continue ahead of the boat. It always spreads behind the boat. In itself, it's a bundle of forces which is directly related to the material existence of boat and its forward motion. One day, an American saw with strange surprise, he was wonderstruck in fact, when he was dragging a boat behind his horse, and at a corner he stopped for a while and he looked at the pattern which started moving ahead of the boat. The boat had stopped. The bundle of energy remained exactly the same bundle of energy which was created by that reality of boat. It moved on. He immediately reported to some scientists, and they started investigating, and they discovered that he was not a liar. It is possible. For the first time in the history of science, they discovered a bundle of energy to exist in itself. Now they have put it to great uses. Many American, Japanese computers, the most advanced computers, contain these bundles in the computer, which work as whatever they have told them to work on. They have created, they know now how to create these bundles, and no matter. No material thing is used. Only these bundle of energies work in computers and unfailingly so. So one of the writers of the article in the end says that long ago, many centuries ago, we parted company with some religious people who sat somewhere by the rock and said, everything, there is a soul, you believe in us. And we said, no question, no soul. He said, the writer says, now when we return to the same spot, we find the same old people sitting there telling us, did we not tell you? Why do you take a journey, circumvent way to reach ultimately the same spot? It's a beautiful expression which he has used, but in fact he doesn't know that he is borrowing from the Quran. The Holy Quran says, Inna lillahi wa inna ilahi raji'un. We all began our journey from God, and ultimately to him we shall return. So this return of the soul is a journey which life took without a soul, but it's developed on the course. As we move forward in evolution, a time came when humans were divided from the animals, which gave them the full support up to that time. And then the soul was created, and the journey back to God commenced from there, not before. So in the heavens you will not find all these animals, nor in hell. Only symbolic animals are shown sometimes in hell, but not in heaven, in the sense that you eat the meat of the tayur, but you don't have their, whatever, their droppings in the heaven at all. So what sort of tayur they are? They have no droppings. No cows, no buffaloes, yet you have canals full of milk flowing. No honeybees are mentioned, yet the honey is flowing full of rivers. Rivers are flowing full of honey, and this is the paradise. Evidently, what is mentioned is spiritual. There will be no physical being there with our form and shape to enjoy any physical form of honey or milk. They're just symbolic. But they do exist in some form. And in that revived form of awareness which we'll receive after our death, the Holy Quran says that the people there will say, it's a different vision which we have now. We can penetrate deep into things. We can read the messages written over our bodies. Now, all this expression indicates that what will happen in the life after death will be something completely different. That is why the Holy Quran repeatedly reminds man that you can't understand. You simply can't understand what will happen in the hereafter. Again, Hazrat Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has given the judgment once and for all, that whatever will happen there will not belong to our dimensions. It will have different dimensions. If it has different dimensions, it cannot have the same body. It's a fantastic thing what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. No prophet of God ever said such a thing. He is speaking on behalf of the modern times, of the most modern 5-6 dimensional scientists, you know. Once in the Holy Quran, when he recited the verse of the Holy Quran, it said that the heavens cover the entire universe. The whole universe, the span of the whole universe covers heavens, and heaven covers the span of the universe. The Sahaba, the companions, were amazed. They said, Ya Rasulullah, where would be the hell? If the entire expanse of the universe is covered by heaven, where will be the hell? You know, he was not ruffled at all. He said, in the same space, but you know not. You cannot realize. According to Ahmadiyya sallallahu alaihi wasallam, hell is not a pit somewhere else while the heavenly people are removed from that pit in distance. Hell occupies the same heavens as is occupied by paradise. The entire expanse of the universe will become hell for some people, and the entire expanse of the universe will become heaven for some others. And this can only happen if there are more dimensions to four we know. Rasulullah must have known that. It must have been shown by God that we are talking of different things in a different language. So tell your people, they can't understand, but they will exist like this. Right? Yes, please. Wa alaikum. You are from?
My name is Rayan Alam. I am from South Africa.
From?
South Africa, yes. I'm a student and also financial secretary of Hudamul Ahmadiyya in Cape Town, South Africa. Huzur, my question is, in the system that Allah has created, righteous actions are rewarded and bad deeds or evil actions are punished. Yet no human being has asked to be born. He hasn't asked to be created. The consequences of which is that Allah, he still has to suffer punishment for whatever bad he does.
Do you think a different law in operation in the universe than the spiritual law which you are speaking about? Do you see a different law in operation in the universe? Does not fire burn? Or does it?
Yes. And
when you poke your nose, if you poke your nose into fire, what would happen? You'll be punished. This is bad act. And when you're thirsty, you drink water, a cool draught of water would fill your body and soul with such peace and tranquility. This is a good reward. So the rewards are not just promised to you, the rewards are being shown to you, demonstrated to you in the life here on earth. When you are given a choice between this and that, this is the choice which makes you different from the angels and jinns and satans and whatever they are. This is why you never see any mention of any reward for angels. Did you ever read in the Quran or Hadith that angels are rewarded? While day in and day out, from morning to evening, they praise Allah. What a beautiful act. But they don't seem to be rewarded at all. The beasts of jungle are not threatened to be punished when they devour other smaller animals, because they are commanded and controlled by their instinctive messages written in their genes. They can't take another course at all. They don't have option. So when there is no option, there is no reward. When there is no option, there is no punishment. The lions must eat flesh willy-nilly. And with that eating of flesh, they do not have any pangs of conscience against which they work. It seems good, it tastes good to eat the flesh of animals. For every bird of prey, for every beast of jungle, the same law exists. And there are cows who it will be hell for them to eat the flesh of other animals. Only here the cows were fed with that infected beef, but in a form that they could eat. But normally you start feeding cows with beef or with mutton or with chicken, they would die in a few days, you know. While the same thing is meat for some others and poison for some others. But they have no choice. So in the hereafter, the same question applies to your question as well. In the hereafter, only those will be rewarded and those will be punished who had a choice to exercise in this world here on earth. Right?
Thank you.
Please. Walim Samvitu Sahib.
My name is Tahir Ahmad. I'm visiting here from Washington. I'm not really prepared with a question.
And what are you to me?
Excuse me?
What are you to me?
I'm your nephew.
Nephew. Oh,
yes.
My youngest sister's son.
And as I said, I'm not prepared with a question, but there is something that sometimes I wonder about, and I think this is a good opportunity to ask you. In an attempt to be righteous...
Would you borrow his microphone for a while? No, it's all right. He's in the
kitchen. Yes,
it's okay.
Okay.
Now repeat your question, please.
My question is, in an attempt to be righteous, as we all try to be...
What do you mean by we all try to be?
Well, at least I try to be, and I don't think I'm there by any means. But
no, what do you really try to be righteous?
I think that's
in many areas you don't try either.
That's true.
So,
but in bits and pieces,
sometimes we consciously pursue goodness.
That's right.
That is the right question.
Right.
All right.
So as I'm trying to consciously pursue goodness.
Right. Not always.
Not always. Not always. That's okay. True. One of the things is that I'm told that we're supposed to be, or we are to be, satisfied with the condition that we find ourselves in. And I think that in that respect, at least I do try to pursue that.
Will you illustrate this point? I can't understand in generalities. You must specify the point, please.
Okay. Whatever physical, financial, material condition that we find ourselves in, I believe that we should be satisfied with that. We should be grateful to Allah.
Satisfied is a different word which does not cover all the connotation of Arabic words for such situations.
That's right.
That is why you find yourself in difficulty.
In difficulty right now.
Qanaat is not satisfaction in this sense.
That's the word I was looking for.
Qanaat, yes. Yeah. If anybody is Qane, it means that whatever has God given him, he would spend only that much and will not outshoot his potential in spending something for him or for his beloved ones. He will not transcend his borders of his potentials. This is qanaat. If somebody is given, a poor man is given just a bread without any condiments, etc., just one square meal, 24 hours, like many Africans are given, and he does not steal, he does not rob, he does not borrow when he knows he will not be able to return that. This is qanaat. But qanaat does not mean that you should not make efforts to improve your life. So if you consider qanaat to mean satisfaction, it is not the right word. Satisfaction is a situation with which you are at peace and you like it, and a sort of stability is reached. While this state of stability in you is practically acceptance of death. This is not life. But if you remain within that state and struggle for your existence and continue to improve your whatever you have, this is not against the Quranic wish. It is exactly in pursuance of the Quranic orders that you must go on improving the quality of your life in every way that you possibly can. But whatever you have, within that, the four wall of what you have, you must not kick up a shindy against the decree of God and say, look here, God has given him that much and this much and this much. I have been provided only with one meal, 24 hours or even less sometimes. That is up to you. That is the decree of God. If you work for your own goodness, you may get it and you may not get it. But the situation would require your understanding of the overall plan of things. Because in certain situations, an individual may work hard to earn his livelihood, but the economic system is unethical. And the individual being a part of a people who are unethical would suffer. But because the choice was given to the people to be good or bad, so God would not enforce the people to take care of every individual. That is the problem. And every individual must work towards the improvement of his position in the society. And society as a whole should also listen to the admonition from God through Sharia's and laws of religious laws, and pay their dues to the unfortunate members of the society who are left unattended at the lowest rung, while the Quran has taken care of them. The Quran admonishes and advises and emphasizes the role of the society to take care of the poor and the needy. Yet the Quran also speaks of freedom of choice. So the freedom of choice here hurts the individual. In that sense, he is commanded by a decree of God, but at the same time, he is free within the four walls of that decree, along with his people. So there are decrees which are wider in their application, like decrees which are commanding the situation in Pakistan nowadays. They're commanded by the same decree. And the same decree commands the British people. And both are given choices. Both either gain from the choices they have adopted or suffer from the choices they have adopted. I have given more answer to your question than you required, huh? No. But I thought it was essential.
It's very good, sir.
Yeah? Good.
Well, sir, I'm really honored to meet you as of course in the past.
Thank you.
And I pray for your long life. Thank you very much.
It's done.
I'm Hussein Sumon. I'm the Emir of Nigeria. My question...
He's the Emir of Nigeria.
My question, sir, is...
Introduce yourself first. This is what you have been doing.
I said I'm Hussein Sumon.
What was your profession? Or what is your profession?
I'm a civil engineer by profession.
Yes. And civil engineer, in your capacity as a civil engineer, do you command a wide area of works in your country or
a small area? Yeah, before I retired, yes.
Tell us more about it. Yes.
About 16 states in the northern part of the country, of Nigeria. Huh. I was the engineer responsible for the
all the development
and construction of highways.
I was responsible, yes, sir. In the northern part?
Yes, sir.
That's good, yes.
But I retired last September.
Yes, I know.
I want to ask, what are the conditions for the acceptance of prayer?
God, what time it is? 19 minutes left, 12. Not for acceptance of your prayer, but for the proceedings, I mean. The question can be answered in light of Hazrat Masih Maud's writings, which I just touched upon during my address at Jalsa. But I will enlarge on that in my speeches, addresses in Germany, inshallah. But in brief, the acceptance of prayer has exactly the same principle which commands human relationship. No difference whatsoever. Except the difference of God being able to give anything which He likes. Humans are not able to do, but they wish to do something for their dear ones. Now, do you always accept the demands of your children?
No, not always.
No? See? When and why do you expect accept them?
Well, when I think
deserve it.
That's right. Yes. So this is the principle of prayers as well. You do not know better what they deserve. But God knows best what you deserve. So the area of acceptance widens in relation to God. And you can't grant them, your children, everything which they deserve, while God can. So that is the difference of the power, the attributes of God to be so overwhelming and transcendent over everything, that whatever he desires, he may do, if he so likes. Otherwise, the rest of the principles of prayer are the same as we observe them between humans and humans in their mutual relationship. Right?
Thank you.
See, sometimes a child cries for fire, like you mentioned. Actually, I have seen children crying that let us poke our hand in the electrical live wires. And they try to push them in. They cry and kick and do this and that, but the mothers would never let them do it. How could God? So, it depends on the prayer, the quality of prayer, the substance of prayer, plus many other things. Moreover, I have also only given you the example of a father or a mother in relation to their children. But there are children who are rebellious.
Yes.
There are children who never listen to their parents. Would you give them readily what you give readily to other children who are so obedient and loving?
Not at all.
Not at all. So, conceive humans as, for instance, the children of God. Most of them are rebellious. They never come to him when he requires them to come to him. They want him to come to him when they require him to come to them. So they try to hold a relationship of a master and a slave between them and God. God would not be your slaves. When you go to him only for demands which you must have fulfilled and do not respond to his demands on you, you are a rebellious child. And why should God fulfill your demand? Only you come only to knock at his door when you need something. While every moment he knocked at your door to recognize him, to be good to fellow human beings, to do this and do that, and you refused. So then, when they rejected, as if they had never prayed, they start talking against God. Look, where is God? No, we don't see. We asked him to grant us this much and he did not do it. So they become even more rebellious than before. But the acceptance of prayer is an issue which has more to it than what I've said. Many things have to be mentioned, but its time is short. Thank you. Any other questions?
As the chairman of the Jalsa committee, I wish that I should be able to make an impact. The Jalsa was instituted by Hazrat, it's been widening and getting more and more popular. What is the spiritual significance of it? And when we are holding Jalsa, what should I look for to make it successful so that I can instill it in the Jalsa committee members?
Are you happy with the Jalsa here?
Very happy.
Look forward to the same things there. Exactly the same things.
Yes.
Right?
Yes, sir.
Only right. I will not be there, but Amit Sahib will be there. He would participate on my behalf. And the rest of the organization should be just perfectly attuned to the requirements of the visitors. Right?
Yes, sir. Okay.
My second question is, the subject of hypocrisy is very early in the Quran.
The subject of hypocrisy.
Hypocrisy. What would be the significance of Allah placing that so early in the Quran, and how could we find ways and means to prevent us from falling into that trap?
Did you ask or did you about humans, according to God, not believing? Did you ask?
Yeah.
It's the same question given in a different twist. The Quran begins with belief and warns us that you think you believe but you do not. And in most situations, your act, your deeds will give a lie to your beliefs. So it was highly essential to warn people about their belief and the sincerity of their beliefs. And then the Quran builds the same issue, the same thing, to a point where everything seems to be apparently confused. Everybody seems to claim he's doing good things. That is exactly what happens in human nature. So the Holy Quran speaks of some criteria to judge yourself, whether really you are sincere in what you claim and you act according to your own claims or not. Otherwise, the Holy Quran says every human thinks he is doing good. Every human thinks he is calling to the right path, while they are not. The question is, after this confusion, how can we wriggle out of this confusion? If everybody believes, and most often his beliefs are not correct, then does God want us to meander into the wilderness of possibilities? We may be right, we may not be right, but when we die, we'll be answerable for what we believed. This is not fair. So the Quran goes on building the theme further and reminds you that if your beliefs, number one, to you yourself, do not possess two different angles. That is why this hypocrisy is mentioned here as a criterion for judging yourself. If you call the people to a path and you do not follow that path yourself, then the claim of sincerity is wrong. If you call the people to follow a certain path and you follow the path yourself, then there should be some reliance on the truth of your belief and the truth of your deeds, not otherwise. Then the Holy Quran speaks of different possible situations where people think they are doing good, but when the same thing is done to them, they don't like it. So that is another criterion for judging right from wrong. They tell others that we beat the believers in the prophets. We treat them ill. We do this and that because they are deviating from the truth. Now, they have also the right to beat the non-believers because they think the truth is right and they are deviating, but they do not. When they come to power, even then they do not. So that is another criterion for judging your truth. If you act God, then whatever beliefs you hold are not true. If you act human and be humble in whatever you believe in, then you will have limitations and you will meekly and humbly socialize with other humans in a manner that you will be watchful of there being no hurt which flows from your side to the others. So the Holy Quran is a fantastic book. It speaks of a subject and gives its different possibilities. At times man thinks that he is confused now. How would he know that he is right or wrong? Then the Holy Quran goes on guiding us. There is no problem for the righteous. Then the last thing about the Quranic style of making you sure that you are on the right path is that you will find God here on earth. The godliness in you, and your character will spread light all around, and people will like you as human beings. Your enemies will not be liked as human beings. They'll be liked only by their own, group or people who move around them, who extol their goodness only to gain some material things from them. Such coterie of people can be seen, of course, in the world. But actually they do not like them. Because in adverse times, when the person, if he holds a state power, the state power is removed from him, the people will also disappear. That shows that these apparent qualities of loyalty to people, loyalty to persons, being around them, they are all false, just images. But about the believers, the Holy Quran says, they love values, and adverse situations do not change them, do not loosen their grip on the values. So with relation to the same hypocrites, is a fantastic verse of the Quran which speaks of a very profound psychic behavior from which you can judge right from wrong. But people read these verses and pass on without noticing what has been said. Holy Quran says that that hypocrites move along with the light of the lightning, and when the lightning stops, they stop. They cannot move on in adverse situations in darkness, but the believers continue to move whatever happens. If goodness from Allah becomes their share, is bestowed upon them, they move on. If they are tried, if trials bring darkness to them, still they move on. But the non-believers or the hypocrites do not do this. So there are just a few examples of the subject which is taken up right in the beginning of the hypocrites is not left alone until it reaches its conclusion. And the conclusion it reaches is that every man can know himself whether he is good or not. And the last thing which I mentioned was, then the fruits appear of this pursuance of goodness with loyalty. And before the fruits, I had to tell you about these trials and things. So in the end, the Holy Quran says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَ اللَّهُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَاللَّهَ تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوَدُونَ نَحْنُ أَوْلِيَاؤُكُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَشْتَهِي أَنفُسُكُمْ وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَدَّعُونَ. People who stand firm and loyal during their trials, neither the night stops their movement forward in the direction of God, goodliness and godliness, nor the light does that, they continuously pursue the same goal. And the trials cannot shake them or uproot them. Stand firm in their trials. How would they know that they are right people, they are godly people, their sacrifice for the sake of God is accepted, and they are different from other people? The Quran says, angels begin to descend upon them. And these are the angels who speak to them through dreams, through visions, through verbal messages. And they tell them that from now on we are going to remain with you. We'll be your guardian angels. We'll protect you. We'll do everything for your sake. In here, this life, as well as in the life after death. What a beautiful book it is. The promises which are made for the future are realized here in this world. That is the ultimate of certainty. When you know you have got what you worked for, you have got the fruits of your labors, then what doubt is left there? Nothing. So the Quranic style of developing a subject and carrying it to its rightful logical conclusion is a style which you will never find in any other book. But you have to be aware of how the Holy Quran deals with these subjects. Right?
Hazur,
martial art.
Just to get away from the martial arts for a second. I brought some papers when I came, and in the paper talked about this Louis Farrakhan from in the Farrakhan. U.S.
That's right.
And how the mullahs from different countries are courting him to do some work for them, and they're going to give him something. I don't know, a title or financial things. I don't know what they're going to give him, but they were having some conference.
They're rewarded somehow.
Yes.
Yes.
How can we, in the U.S. in particular, how can we combat some of the negative things that they may be doing against the Jamaat?
You can always combat the negative things with the positive things you possess, not otherwise. The Holy Quran is very clear on this. Ilfa billati hi asan sayya. This is the message of the Quran. Remove what is bad by replacing it with your own goodness, not otherwise. So the principal communist philosophy of annihilation of what is bad is not supported by the Quran. It is rejected. You have no right to annihilate anything which you don't like. You have only the right to annihilate it if you replace it with a better thing. So, Idfa billati hi asan sayya is the lasting principle of the Quran which applies to every situation. When people are bad, you just don't destroy them because they're bad. You must be good to them, or show to them what goodness is. And the goodness has a quality of dispelling darkness. So the Quran requires you to treat such moments with your own principled behavior and conduct, which you know is always good. So if it is good and you show your character in that society will certainly take note of that. They will gradually be drifting away from them and will move into your direction. But in all such advices, the Holy Quran also speaks of patience. Whenever such subject is mentioned, that you remove evil with your own goodness, the Holy Quran also somehow speaks of patience. It can only be achieved if you are patient. If you want easy, quick results, then you will fail. So goodness will succeed when it is patient, not otherwise. Right?
Yes.
And with that, we lose our patience in a way, but not patience. In fact, the time is over and we have to leave, we have to call it a day. So I hope inshallah we'll meet next week, the same time, the same day. Not the same persons, of course. But I'm always here to answer the questions of English-speaking people on Sundays at the same time. Right? Thank you very much for your participation. I enjoyed meeting you and answering your questions. Assalamu alaikum.